Good afternoon. I'm Mike Gallagher. I'm a former InvenTeam teacher, and now I'm a master teacher for the Lemelson MIT organization. And today is a day to celebrate the work of students at both the high school, undergrad and graduate level. We have a bunch of award winners today presenting for us. You're gonna have three high school InvenTeams, one team that won at the undergraduate level and one at the graduate level. Today is a day that we're celebrating the work of the students and also the foundation themselves to celebrate the things that they've accomplished and the work that they've encouraged throughout the many years at the Lemelson Foundation. So we're gonna start off with a high school invent team, Osmoro High School Invent Team in Osmoro, Wisconsin. They've invented a device that's able to measure lake ice thickness, and they've crowdsourced a map. So next up, we're on.
All right, so hi, we're Omro and Ben team, and in our team we have Jake Kniggy, who's in a part of the financial and the sensor, Sawyer Wheeler, who's in the sensor, Jamie Rice, who's a part of the communication research, and then three people that's in our design team, which is Dalton A. Strike, William White, and Mason Thompson. And then there's me, Delia Larson, the team leader. And we're from a small rural town of Omro in eastern Wisconsin. So there are many outdoor activities that people engage in based on their geographic location. The farther northern regions have the opportunity to engage in snow and ice-related activities. As winter approaches, people go out ice fishing and snowmobiling. Going out on the ice can be dangerous. Once snow covers the lakes and streams, it can be hard to determine how thick the ice is. So ice is inherently unsafe, even in the best conditions. And our invention reduces the risk of breaking through by providing data to make smart decisions. The thickness of the ice determines the safety and how much weight can be supported. And then the dangers lie when individuals go out on the ice, but have no clue how thick the ice is. And Iggy is designed to gather data related to ice thickness safely. So based on our research, approximately 8,000 people nationwide will fall through the ice every year. These breakthroughs can cause hypothermia and cardiac arrest, which can end in fatalities. When your body hits the cold water, the shock can also lead to drowning. And then we also discovered that the cost to retrieve a vehicle from a breakthrough can cost $25,000 or more.
We researched other designs similar to ours. One was a sensor that people use for ice buildup on aircrafts and other sensors used for ice hockey rinks, which were already patented for finding ice thickness. The only issue with these designs was that it had to be embedded in the ice. For our design, we wanted to receive information of the ice thickness by being on the surface, not embedded. Another piece of technology we looked into was ground penetrating radar. It had the ability to achieve our goals, but the cost of the device was quite expensive. Most entry-level models were well over $3,000. Currently, we have not found a patented device or a commercial product that is similar enough to our design's purpose, and we plan to file for a provisional patent within the next year.
Through testing in our ice lab, we've been able to get accurate voltage measurements for different thicknesses of ice. After trying many possible ways to measure ice thickness, we found that an AC ERT worked the best. We repurposed the ERT technology, which is commonly used over large underground distances to see geographic structures underground like oil and water reservoirs. We made that distance a much smaller gap of a few inches to measure the ice thickness at a single point, which essentially lets us see the thickness of the ice. Iggy measures ice thickness reliably up to about 8 inches at its current size, or about half its own length. Data that we gathered is summarized in the next image. Essentially, we discovered that voltages that are measured by our sensors decrease as the ice gets thicker, and that there is an ideal distance between sensors and how deep the measurement can be considered accurate. In our initial setup, we could determine a consistent voltage to thickness ratio of up to 5 inches of ice, and then the voltage readings started to flatline. This helped us determine that once the ice was about half as thick as the length of Iggy, we hit the effective maximum of our sensor. To describe simply how the ERT technology works, you need to imagine the ice as a resistor in a circuit. And as we apply current through different thicknesses of ice, we receive readouts of voltages that change with the thickness. As the ice gets thicker, the voltages that make it from emitter to sensor get lower. Iggy has also gone over many changes in design. From the drivable robot on the left to the original puck design in the middle, and now our newest puck design on the right. The length of the puck is directly related to how deep we can measure through ice. Using our acrylic grid setup helped us to determine the best spacing for the four electrodes. The elliptical shape of Iggy allows us to maximize the length of the sensor without having the device become too bulky or unnecessarily large.
After further discussions, we decided we wanted to gather more information about the ice than just the ice thickness, because ice thickness is not the only indicator of safe ice. We chose an IR thermometer, humidity sensor, and RGB reflectivity sensor, which all need to either see the outside world or be in it to take measurements. These are encased in plexiglass or RTV silicone sealant to prevent water infiltrating into the electrodes. These three sensors will tell us about the crystalline structure of the ice, its surface temperature, and if it's melting. This data will need to be cataloged and put through machine learning after human identification of ice characteristics that correlate with the measurements from the sensors. We currently have Iggy interface with a cell phone to log and view data that is generated by the sensors. Iggy is made of PLA, or polyacetic acid plastic. This makes it waterproof, non-corrosive, lightweight, and durable. Considering 3D printing is inexpensive and is the main component of the Iggy body, this makes the product affordable. This covered one of our criteria of the cost being less than $300. We estimate that the body and internal electronic components to be at a price of around $150. Iggy is deployable by tossing or sliding onto the ice surface. Our device only weighs about 2 pounds and is only about 14 inches long, which makes it very easy to carry. Overall, our finished device fits all of our design requirements. Iggy is easily deployed, lightweight, portable, inexpensive, and measures ice thickness, reflectivity, ice temperature, GPS location, and humidity.
Okay, so for the next steps we plan on doing is real-world testing of Iggy during the 2021 winter season. And then this will include testing sites similar to like our lab simulations, as well as sites with snow cover, wet ice, very cold ice, and uneven surfaces. We also want to determine the limits of this technology in terms of thickness that it can measure. Taking our experimental setup on the lake ice will help us determine the maximum thickness and subsequent length of another version of the Iggy prototype. We plan to work directly with a local company, Sunk Ice and Dive, to stress test and evaluate our current design and advise changes to make it more user-friendly. We also want to integrate the app to the cloud and compile crowdsourced user data to the public use, so people without the device can also make decisions about ice safety. This will also allow huge amounts of data to be collected for eventual machine learning algorithms. Inherently, no ice is safe, and we want to help people make more educated decisions with Iggy. This tool could greatly reduce accidents on the ice and keep people safe while enjoying their winter activities. We want to thank everyone involved for their contributions to this project and all the knowledge they imparted on us. This has truly been a unique and awesome experience that has changed the way we see and analyze the world we live in and change it for the better.
Okay, great job. So I just want to let everyone know that there is a question and answer button on the bottom of your screen. If you have questions, please type them in there and I will bring them to the students. I already have a couple that have come through, but if anybody else has any, go ahead and pass them along. So I'm going to ask right now of you guys, just a couple that are already up there. So the first one that came in, can thick ice with a crack in it still be dangerous?
So thick ice with a crack in it usually means that it's safer ice because it's more thick and it's been built on layers, but it still can be very dangerous just because it can split at any moment.
So the next question is, does salt content change the sensitivity or effectiveness, equivalency of the ice strength? So if there's salt mixed in with the ice, is that something that you could possibly measure for? Is it gonna affect the strength of the ice?
We might be able to measure for that, but we haven't looked into that yet just because most of the lakes and places that people go fishing have a very low content in the water. So there wouldn't be much of a point for the purposes that we created this.
Do you restrict data from the end users to avoid poor decisions? So are they given are the end users given all of the data, or are they given just a, it is safe or not safe? I'm trying to paraphrase.
So far we are planning on giving them all the data and then making them have a decision based on that information.
So is there a watchdog or monitor or self-test of the device to prevent false positives? Tough question. Is there a secondary measure that you guys have used to ensure the quality of your device? I guess would be a better way I could phrase it for you.
We haven't gotten quite to that yet. I think as Dahlia listed at the end of our presentation, we didn't get to a ton of testing, especially not in the real world, just because once we finally had the sensor and things were working, it was too warm and all the ice had already melted. So I think we'll be doing more of that this next winter.
So, the next question is, how long of a time period did it take for you to come up with this and to get it to a functional device?
So we had, last year, we participated in the Samsung Solve for Tomorrow competition, and that's where we got the start for the device. And we were originally using a different type of sensor, but as we started it up again this year, we found that that sensor just was not giving us reliable measurements. And so we kind of had to start over again. I don't think we had a working sensor until, I think it was after February. So it took us quite a while to get a working sensor. And then I don't think we had a finalized body until 3 weeks ago. So it's been quite a long trip.
Okay. So this will be a question for me. This will be my only question of you guys. If you were to go back in time and you were to speak to yourself at the beginning of this process, what advice would you give yourself?
I would say that the best advice would be to reach out to others to try and find help, because we tried countless different sensors to try and find one that actually worked. And we ended up having to talk to Paul Fusel, who helped us a lot with developing a sensor that actually worked for measuring ice thickness.
Awesome. Okay. So we've got some questions that actually came through. There is the for those of you in the audience, there's a chat button, and then to the left of it, there's a button that says Q&A, so question and answer. If you hit that, the questions will appear over here for me. Okay, so. I guess we have time for, I'm just going to have this be your last question. There was one that came through on the actual chat. And it is, what made you choose your circuit design for your invention?
So the circular design was more use because we wanted it to look like a puck and make it easily throwable and retrievable. But then we had to switch it more into ellipsis design because of the sensor we were using.
Okay. So, great job, everybody. Fantastic work. Impressive to see this done from anybody. Amazing that it's done at the high school level. You should be very proud of yourself and all that you've done. Next up, we have from the undergrad award winner, we have it the Eat It undergrad award winner, Benjamin Johnson and Zane Zents, and they've invented a grain bin safety and management robot that helps farmers.
Thanks, Mike. Go ahead and share our screen here real quick.
Awesome. Hey, good afternoon, everyone. I'm Ben Johnson.
And I'm Zane Zents. We're undergrad students from Omaha, Nebraska, and we're the inventors of the Grain Weevil, a grain bin safety and management robot.
So a couple of years ago, our good friend Zach challenged us to build him a robot so neither he nor his sons would ever have to go into a grain bin again. Grain bins are hot, extremely dirty, and very dangerous workplaces. To adequately manage stored grain, farmers are exposed to potential falls, entrapments, auger entanglements, and long-term conditions such as farmer's lung. On the nearly 450,000 American farms with grain bins, farmers take these risks over 6 million times a year. Grain needs to be managed during the entire storage process, and a farmer with a shovel has always just been the best solution. Unfortunately, this led to 20 entrapment deaths in 2020 alone. And even worse, one out of every 5 grain bin accidents are teenage boys.
So how's the industry addressing this problem now? As Ben just mentioned, a farmer with a shovel and that can-do attitude is the most common answer. Other solutions include extremely heavy equipment that's either boomed into the grain bin or permanently attached to every bin. For example, one of our biggest competitors can address a lot of the issues we're trying to solve. They have a laundry list of products where each addresses only one or two of the problems in the bin. This approach is expensive, not flexible, and still leaves the farmer with reasons to enter a bin.
We have created a robot that we feel can not only keep the farmer out of the grain bin, but fundamentally change how grain bins are managed. The Grain Weevil addresses storage challenges by working smarter, not harder. It scurries across the top of the grain using auger-based propulsion. An auger is essentially a screw that we utilize like tank tracks on either side of the robot to move throughout the grain. And by doing this, it reduces the viscosity of the grain, which lets gravity do the rest of the work, smoothing out the walls of grain that build up and breaking up those crusts and bridges. It's lightweight, portable, and powerful enough to take the place of a farmer with a shovel.
So the Grain Weevil currently weighs in at just under 30 pounds. It's designed to be installed permanently into a bin, but we can also move it easily from bin to bin. Some of the features include a swappable payload bay, expandable battery packs, a video stream, and a basic sensor package. Right now, the robot can be driven by a handheld remote, but eventually we're gonna make it operate completely autonomously. We're also designing the robot to be paired with multiple other robots in a swarm of individual grain weevils so that it can handle larger tasks inside bigger bins.
The grain weevil is intentionally designed as what we call a semi-industrial robot. So we have focused on simplicity and robustness so that the robot relies on intelligence to live inside of the bin. Grain bins are horrible working environments like we talked about for humans, but they're also terrible for robots. So we kept this in mind when we were designing the grain weevil and made it affordable and very easy to fix or replace.
So the grain weevil robot addresses three of the main issues that grain farmers face today. The first one is grain bin safety. Entrapments can take place when a farmer's in a bin and someone else starts the extraction augers, when steep walls of corn avalanche onto a farmer trying to instigate flow, and as that diagram on the top shows, when a crust forms, creating a bridge that a farmer tries to break up with force, and it'll collapse underneath the farmer. The ability to keep a farmer safe is priceless.
Second is the efficient extraction of the grain. So as the robot encourages the flow of grain, the auger extraction inside of the bin can work to its full capacity, which could save the farmer countless hours and labor costs. This also eliminates the risks of getting caught in those augers as the farmer tries to manually get the last bit of grain out of the bin.
And the last thing we're trying to address with the grain weevil is managing the quality of the grain storage through inspections, leveling, and dispersing the grain while it's loading. So our research shows that worldwide, up to 20% of cereal grain loss comes during the storage phase of the supply chain. And that equates to about $300 billion worth of food loss each year. As we move from the prototyping phase to the beta testing phase, we'll demonstrate how the grain weevil can make an impact on post-harvest grain loss. The grain weevil is impacting the quality of stored grain and farmer well-being by controlling costs, controlling risks, and removing the farmer from the bin.
Our main focus is on the farm storage, which includes over 440,000 farms with permanent grain storage. With over 1 million grain bins in the US alone, and farmers spending approximately $20,000 per year in storage costs for a moderate-sized bin, there is a definite need for the grain weevil. We have also explored potential industrial markets and are finding even more interesting use cases for the grain weevil. As you can see there, our company sits within a day's drive of 70% of the total on-farm grain storage in the United States, which gives us a big advantage.
It starts with grain bins, but the story doesn't end there. The grain weevil is on a mission to become the ag robot that does the work that no farmer should. Thank you.
Let's do some questions.
Wow, impressive stuff. Guys, that's amazing. So once again, I've got some tough questions coming through for you.
Thanks.
So first one, do you see this possibly being used for cleaning concrete trucks or sanitation sewers or other similar industrial applications?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, we're always looking for other use cases for the grain weevil. Right now, our biggest focus is just on, you know, helping individual farmers with their grain bins. We're trying to, you know, our main mission is safety. And on the way, you know, we're having some economic impact as well. But our main issue right now is the safety of farmers and the producers of our food across the country. But as we move forward, as we prove out our ability to help in grain bins, we also are definitely looking forward to working in other environments. You know, concrete trucks, I haven't heard that one yet, but we've heard things like salt piles and pig troughs and just, you know, we're trying to get it anywhere where we can fit it in.
Next up, can this be used to rescue or protect the farmer if he or she chooses to enter and a poor decision is made?
I want to be very careful when we talk about this for obvious reasons, but there are potentially situations where the grain weevil could be used to deliver tools or safety equipment inside of a grain bin. But our ultimate goal is that no one ever gets into a grain bin again. And we think we can do that with our robot.
So the question is here, I guess what would be the strategy or how could you see this coexisting with a traditional farmer? how would you convince them to transition over to a device of this nature?
Yeah, so that's one of the big challenges coming into the agriculture industry is farmers really don't like the word robot, and throwing more technology into something that's becoming even more and more, you know, entrenched in a lot of these technological advancements that farmers don't necessarily have the tools or the time to learn or understand. They're wary about having new technology come in. But we're lucky that grain bins are one of those very rare cases where if we can take that job off the farm, no matter how we do it, a farmer is going to be happy. And so we've managed, I think, to keep the cost pretty low and to keep the benefits pretty enticing. So even, you know, small farmers will be really excited about this, about never climbing into a grain bin ever again.
So there's that transition from getting the old traditional farmer to use this device, but we have here today with us a bunch of young inventors. And clearly you guys were inspired by a friend, and you're very talented that you're able to come up with this on your own. But what words of wisdom would you give to this young group of inventors to set them on the path that you've already chose to go on?
My main point would be to get involved in extracurriculars. The ability, I don't know everyone's situation, but I grew up in a rural town, and there were not opportunities inside of school to do engineering and go beyond the classroom. So I participated in high school robotics outside of the school. That's where I learned a lot of this technology and got to learn how to build this robot that we have now. So getting involved as much as you can in what you're passionate about really will set you forward.
One of the things that we hear very often is to hurry up and fail and embrace failure. So what's an example of something that you guys think failed for you, but you learned in?
I mean, when we started this project, I mean, it probably took us
over a year
to even get like the first working prototype. And even before that, I mean, we've had other projects that we've worked on where we completely, you know, fail. And you can look at it as a complete failure, or you can take something from it. And so I was never involved with robotics before. Ben was. But even through these failures, I learned so much. And each step of the way, I kept building on that knowledge and learning. And so as we took that information, we built a better and better project that impressed more people. We got more and more feedback, and that's all failure is, just another form of feedback. So
about how you take it.
Exactly.
So this will be my last one to you before the next group goes up. Your friend reached out to you, and why was it that he picked you guys?
It's an interesting story. I talked about how I built robots in high school, and I, towards the end of high school, sort of got into doing some of my own projects for different companies, just small, just so I could learn the industry a little bit. And he had seen one of the robots I built and was impressed, and just off the cuff said, "Hey, you should build me one of these so I don't ever have to get into this nasty grain bin." And as non-ag people, we're like, "That's interesting. We don't know much about that, but you have a real problem and we know how to build robots. So let's work together." And he's been with us ever since, pushing us, helping us test and things. So finding someone with a real problem, even if you're not, as long as you're willing to learn, it's a fun process. And we were able to push it as far as we could.
That's awesome. Great job, guys. Great presentation. Great project. Great robot.
Thanks, Mike.
Yep. Next up, we have Smithtown High School, and they've invented a device that monitors social distance for students with autism spectrum.
Thank you, Mr. Gallagher.
Hi everyone, we're the Smithtown High School West InvenTeam, located on Long Island in New York. Our team members are Eric Pentecost, Akib Syed, Kelsey Most, myself, Jensen Herbst, Madeline Raley, Sinead Doyle.
Ryan Keane to guidance.
Rayhan Mian, Tyler Nagoski, Liza Lesage, and Patrick Notov. We're all high school juniors and are led by our research teacher, Dr. Joanne Figueredo. I'll now pass the presentation on to my colleague, Rayhan Mian.
Our invention is a small device whose purpose is to help students with autism spectrum disorder, also known as ASD, who use repetitive behaviors to cope with stressful and uncomfortable situations. However, our device intends to break this pattern. And allow kids with ASD to understand the idea of personal space. Our device aims to benefit and establish a strong social connection between students with ASD and their mentors, teachers, friends, and family. I'll now pass it on to my colleague, Eric Pentecost.
So we have conducted numerous interviews to show the struggles that are associated with autism spectrum disorder. Such as we have made interviews with Dr. Michael Alessandri, an executive director of the University of Miami Center for Autism and Related Disabilities, as well as Mrs. Amy Bells and her son Carson, who has ASD, and Mr. Christopher Cortali. These interviews have greatly informed us about new methods to go about with our device, such as the inclusion of an app to serve as an educational tool, and also how important it is to include the ASD community. Sorry, that's our school bell. We also found from our interviews how important it is to include the ASD community in our experiments and the design of our invention. As we learned of a quote, nothing about us without us. We also learned how important that our device will make as an impact on kids that have ASD who struggle with the idea of personal space. I'll now introduce my colleagues, Madeline Raley and Kelsey Most, to talk about uniqueness.
We have ensured that our device is different than existing technologies through various means, including patent searches and interviews with special education teachers. A patent search using the U.S. Patent and Technology Office website and free patents online was conducted in order to assure that our device is unique. We used specific keywords that related to our idea in order to find patents that shared features of our invention. Upon further research into each of the four similar patents, they were all different from ours in various ways. For example, some were not made specifically to aid the autism community, and others were not designed to gauge personal space. However, the one aspect of our device that was completely unique from anything we found was that we have an app to work alongside the device itself to collect and monitor data and track the user's progress.
Furthermore, in every interview that we've had so far, the people we met with were unaware of any technologies similar to ours. We spoke with several stakeholders in the ASD community. These people include Amy Bells, Dr. Micah Alessandri, Mrs. Lisa Felice, Mrs. Stephanie McKinney, and Christopher Cortale. They have all assured us that they have never seen a device like this and that it would definitely be helpful. So both patent searches and our interviews have clearly revealed that our device is unique and will be beneficial to the students that use it.
So after we conducted interviews and research, we made some design criteria. First, we felt the device should be small, and we decided on the dimensions of 3 by 2 by 1.5 inches. Sound was figured out as, after testing the device, we realized that a vibration used around 2 volts of power can be felt while still being quiet. Finally, our last criteria was battery life. We settled on a device runtime of around 8 hours, and even after utilizing a relatively small battery of about 2,000 milliamps, we succeeded this with about 10 to 12 hours worth of battery life. So after prototyping on a breadboard, we decided to use the perf board because it allows us to see many issues we may have experienced if we jumped right to a finalized PCB. We found numerous problems with our design, mainly relating to constraints of having to fit a lot of electronic components into a small space. But ultimately, we made adjustments and finalized a perf board prototype, which my colleague Akib Syed will talk about our testing with our perf board prototype.
So we also used the perf board prototype to complete multiple tests to track the accuracy and consistency of the device. we had one person representing the child with autism wearing the device while another person stood in front of them. The person with the device would walk, and once they felt the device vibrate, they'd stop and read the distance they got. This was done for 25 trials each, with the distance with the device being calibrated to 4 feet and 6 feet. So the distance we measured closely matched the actual distance, with the median for both tests being only 2 inches off, showing the precision of the device. I will now pass it back to Tyler to talk about the PCB prototype.
So currently we are on the final stage of our design prototype chain, PCB. This will be the smallest and most securely connected board. The 3D printed case will have a lid that will snap fit onto the case with holes on either side for the switch and charging port. On the far right, you can see the direct comparison between the size of the perf board prototype and the PCB prototype. Measuring at just 2.5 by 2 by 1.5 inches, the PCB prototype is by far the smallest version of our device. Now I'll invite Akib Syed back on to talk about the app.
So along with the device, we have a prototype version of an app to be used alongside it. So the purpose of the app is for a caretaker to be able to gain an insight under the hood of the device. So it uses Bluetooth to connect with the device, set thresholds for the device, as well as other settings such as the duration of vibration. The app also displays an interactive chart of the data that the device sends back, which can help monitor progress over time. So the next steps, we would love to experiment with different microcontrollers, such as the Arduino Nano and BLE technology, pictures to the right. This can help us with potential reductions in the size of our device. Next, we would like to test specifically on children with autism to gain their valuable insight on our device. And finally, our ultimate goal is to add documentation and make this project open source for all. Next, I would like to introduce my colleague, Shanid Doyle, to talk about our IRB.
In order to test our device, we realized that we required the approval of an institutional review board, IRB. This is because we are testing the device on a highly protected group, which is children with special needs. We worked to devise a testing protocol and a student-teacher survey to assess the ability of our device to alert the student and then relay the message back to the teacher. We submitted our procedure to a company that provides IRB approval, and we received the full approval. Once the device has been finalized and we are all set to test on the candidates, which will consist of at least 10 autistic kids, and that will be determined by our special educators. I'll now reintroduce my colleague, Kelsey Must.
So to conclude, we'd like to thank various groups for their help during the creation of this device. We thank the Smithtown community and special educators for their tremendous support in our device. We'd like to thank everyone who performed an interview with us, allowing us to gain insight and feedback. We'd also like to thank Mr. Glenn Meyerowitz for his technical insight to the engineers and help building the device throughout every step. We'd like to thank Dr. Joanne Figueredo, our amazing mentor who helped us stay focused, provided us with numerous resources, and created weekly meetings for us to stay connected. And finally, we'd like to thank Lemelson MIT for not only providing us the platform to speak about our device, but also providing financial support. Thank you.
Great work. Exciting stuff. Let me get my questions up here. So how and where did you learn PCB design?
So PCB design, we use the program called EasyEDA. It's a free online tool for PCB design. Learning the actual electronic, like how to build a schematic, that was just hours and hours of looking at data sheets and documentation.
And what CAD platform did you use?
For CAD, we use Fusion 360.
And I must have missed it. You mentioned a summer research program early on in your presentation. There's a question about what was the name of the summer research program?
I don't really know if there was an actual name for it, but we just went to Brentwood High School near our school, and Ms. Fig, our science teacher, brought along us, and that's how we started developing our project. And it was kind of introducing us to the idea of science research and what it was all about.
Awesome. So I have an opportunity here while we get maybe another question, but a question I asked the first group was, if you were to go back in time and talk to yourself at the beginning of this thing, what's the advice you'd give yourself?
So one of the main things that I would say to my previous self would be to leverage our mental resources more heavily than we did. I know Tyler and I, we tried to solve the problems ourselves as students. And as good as that is, it's really helpful for us to like utilize mentors to speed the whole process up.
Awesome. Do we have any other questions from the audience? And I'll throw one more out to you then. What do you think your greatest learning opportunity was?
Yeah, so probably our greatest opportunity was being able to learn how to work as a team and be able to trust in others to complete tasks that otherwise, as like student inventors and student science research students, we would otherwise do it ourselves, but we learned to develop skills of having trust in others and understanding that they can do it too.
Awesome. Great job. Great presentation. Love the invention. Awesome work. Okay. So next up we have the EDIT Graduate Prize winner, Hilary Johnson. She's created an adaptive centrifugal pump that expands or contracts the volume in response to variable flow rates for better energy efficiency. Was I even close, Hilary? You're muted.
You're doing great. And I would love to tell you more about it. So my name is Hilary Johnson, and pumps are an invisible yet absolutely essential fluid driver in our infrastructure. In the next 5 minutes, I want to convince you why you should be pumped about pumps. Or at the very least, I want to tell you why I see research and development in pump systems as essential to building equitable and safe and climate resilient infrastructure for the next 100 years. So as I said, my name is Hilary Johnson. I'm an inventor in the Lemelson MIT Student Prize. I'm currently a PhD student in mechanical engineering at MIT. And it is so cool to see all the other teams presenting today, because I see myself in you when I was both a high school student and an undergrad, and the projects I worked on then that have given me the experience to do what I'm doing today. So I work at the Water Energy Nexus to build resilient and efficient systems. And part of that are these pumps. So my invention is a patent-pending centrifugal pump with adaptive geometry that changes the volume of the pump. As you can see here in this little animation, it changes the volume of the pump in real time. And I'll go into more of the details in a moment, but this really improves the pump efficiency, the operating range, and reliability. So even if you may not know it, pumps are integral to your daily life. Centrifugal pumps move fluid through our industrial and municipal systems. Like, they provide pressure for the clean water to come out of your tap. Or they also move wastewater through treatment facilities, like this one in Boston. This facility fills 3 skyscrapers a day with wastewater, and all of that is pumped. Pumps also irrigate crops for all of our food production. Let's see. Okay, so food production, as the grain weevil team was talking about, and they also move oil and gas through production, and they pump water in hydro batteries and reservoirs. So they are both moving fluids through our systems and also providing a store of energy through hydropower and reservoirs. And so in all of these ways, pumps are these invisible fluid drivers. In the US, centrifugal pumps consume 6% of electricity annually. So is that big? Is that not? That's actually equivalent to the energy output of 56 Hoover dams. And that's the CO2 production of almost 24 million cars. That's a lot of CO2 production and energy. And this really motivates me to look at how do we make more reliable and energy efficient pumps in each of these applications. So how does a centrifugal pump work? Centrifugal pumps suck water in the center of the pump, as you can see here, and then fling the water outwards like a merry-go-round, using what's called centrifugal force. The water is flung into a spiral chamber, like it's almost like a snail shell, and it moves around and out until it's pushed out through the outlet. The energy is transferred to the water using an impeller, which are these rotating blades that push the fluid using the centrifugal force. So the efficiency of a pump is dependent on matching the flow out of the impeller into the spiral volume. However, pumps currently are a set size, and so they're not able to adapt to varying flows throughout the day. So I invented a pump that can change, that can expand and contract in size, which can adjust to changes in the flow rate. And this simple ability to adjust to a broader range of flows improves the pump efficiency and reliability. This new centrifugal pump, and in fact, this whole new category of centrifugal pumps with adaptive geometry, improves the efficiency, operating range, and reliability in pump systems. So I built this innovation, and so we can see here a conceptual representation of what's actually going on inside. So we can see the impeller rotating on this cross-sectional view, and the red piece that's translating up and down, which is what's changing the volume. And so I built this innovation starting from just a hypothesis and a differential equation, which is why learning math in high school is so awesome and useful. And so I took it from this like really basic hypothesis all the way to a working industrial scale prototype that I'm currently testing. And using these fluid fundamentals and experiments, I first showed that varying the pump geometry in response to these fluctuating flows would increase the efficiency. And then using precision machine design principles, I invented the dynamic pump mechanism that I'm working on testing today. So our patent pending mechanism adapts to the optimal geometry for the best efficiency. And the current prototype I'm testing enables a 6x increase in the operational range compared to what currently exists. So when COVID hit, I couldn't access my experimental setup at MIT. So I pivoted and I built a backyard testable pump as a scalable template. It was backed by design equations and hydraulic calculations such that I could then scale it up. So I'm currently working on the industrial scale pump, and I've been 3D printing, machining, and assembling my prototypes and then testing them out in this flow loop to get data in order to quantify the efficiency and reliability impacts of this mechanism. So you can see here a few photos of me in the lab. And I'm partnering with a company called Xylem, which is a global water technology company with $5 billion in annual revenue. And they are going to license the patents for this technology. And I'm working with them in order to develop a plan to scale up and commercialize this technology. And they really truly envision this variable volume mechanism as the first in a whole new category of adaptive pumps. So working at the water energy nexus, I see how climate change really mandates that we need these efficient, adaptable pump systems at terawatt scale. Growing cities also need expanded capacity for clean and wastewater, as well as building, heating, and cooling. And all of these are dependent on the pumps that are installed. So these adaptive pumps show potential to improve this efficiency with a smaller footprint than equivalent systems. I want to say a great thank you to all of my mentors and my partner Xylem for your collaboration, and also a thank you to the Lemelson Foundation for your support and recognition. And with that, I will take any questions.
Okay, great. So let me see, we've got questions for you. So last couple there, okay. So, sorry. How do you adjust the motor speed or torque to match the variable volume of the pump?
That's a great question. So we're still working on what that control and optimization algorithm looks like. Currently, variable speed drives or changing the motor speed is the most common way of adapting a pump. And so we see that collaborating with this variable volume, and both of them are dependent on flow. So there are what are called pump curves. There's an operating curve and a system curve, and you use those characteristics to then identify what is the like optimal speed or optimal volume to operate at. And I could get really technical, but that's the, the high level answer.
I'm gonna trust you on that one. So then there was just a follow-up. Was it variable frequency devices?
Variable frequency drives are the same as a variable speed drive. And that's like the motor that's able to change.
Okay. So I guess without a question on here right now, in speaking with the students, the high school students who have just lived through this inventive cycle that you did yourself, what's the advice that you would give to them or the young inspired inventors that are out there?
That's a great question. So I'll pass on some advice that a mentor gave to me when I was a younger engineer, which is to look around you and always ask, how is that made? How is that made? How is that made? Like my cell phone here, like how is the case manufactured? Or how does the camera adjust the lens length to be able to take such accurate photos? Or how do we make like 10 billion Legos a year? And to that sort of curiosity and asking just about the simple things around us really helped me then understand how do things work. I also love watching YouTube videos on how it works. And those are also really fun.
So we did get some great questions for the students on the technical side. And I think they came primarily from adults, but maybe we could get some of the students to put a question in here or two for Hilary. And I'll ask you the question that I asked the students. If you were to go back and give yourself a piece of advice, what would it be? Other than you're doing everything perfect.
Oftentimes when you're like applying for jobs or you're starting your own company, you begin to build a portfolio of your work. Which I would totally recommend. I have a website, you can check it out as an example, hilaryannajohnson.com. But it's really important to document what you're doing, but I also keep a failure portfolio of the things that didn't work, the things that fell apart, the welds that didn't stick together the first time, the computer code that had all the bugs, the machine learning algorithm that gave me results that didn't make sense. Because those moments of failure were often what then led to the like incredible successes. And I think inventing, as all the teams have learned, inventing something really requires a grit and tenacity to keep pushing through the 5-10 ideas that didn't work until you get to the one that did. And so I think the failure portfolio for me is actually what I'm most proud of, because it's all the like crazy wacky ideas that I tried that were part of my journey to getting to this patent pending mechanism that will be commercialized.
That's a fantastic idea. I think we often just run from the things that didn't work out as we planned, but there's so much of learning that takes place. Having a repository where you put it down and you champion those things. So I'll ask you one last question here. I missed it. Shoot, came through in the questions on the side here. So what is the hardest part of fluids and physics for you?
Well, I wasn't always good at math. It's actually something that I've come to later on. I think it's because I didn't always see how useful it was. But I love, there are like second order differential equations that describe the flow of the fluids inside of these pumps. And like one of the visualizations I showed with like all the colors spiraling through the pump, that's a visual representation of the solution to those differential equations. And so it's initially non-intuitive and challenging to look at how does this equation then relate to this like real prototype I'm building. But actually this whole idea started out by looking at an equation and saying, hey, everyone thinks that this height volume variable is static. Like we shouldn't change that. And similar to what Professor Henry said in the introduction, he said, well, always question things. And so my question was, well, what if we could make a pump that changes? And then it is falling from there. So math is really cool and really hard. And I think often not taught well, but
certainly worth it to keep trying and keep thinking about it.
Awesome. Thank you. Great job. So next up, we have Gilbreath-Reed Career and Technical Center Invent Team from Garland, Texas. They've invented a new way to sanitize firefighters' boots. Created a station to do it.
Hello. Quality, is the quality of sound quality good up in here as well?
Yeah.
I take it we're on mute. So, hello, we are the GRCTC. I am Ernesto, the lead technical designer and responsible for a lot of the CAD.
My name is John Mongold. I'm the medical lead and as well as the media lead.
Oh, my name is Reese Nahosa, and I was working with the coding and wiring.
And today we're just going to run through y'all our invention and project we've been working on for the past year. We've had a lot of help from a lot of great mentors that we're going to mention today. And I'm just going to start with telling us our overview is just kind of going over the solution for what our problem was, how we did it, all of our trials and errors. And at the very end, we're going to go over sustainability and what we're hoping to see for the years following after this. As you can see, that was an exceptional display of the speed that firefighters need to have to respond to calls on the moment for 24 hours shifts at a time. It's a 6-man crew, which needs to always be on standby. Most of the calls aren't even fires. They're actually related to health or other hazards, meaning they're at risk of coming in contact with a lot of potentially hazardous pathogens or other microbes of the sort, as well as contaminants. They don't clean their equipment as often because of needing to be on call all the time. So time for actually cleaning their equipment can be scarce because they're not sure when they'll be called again. This is one of the issues that we had to tackle when designing this and goes into our design criteria for our contraption. We specifically designed to help clean their boots since those are one of the pieces of equipment that come into contact with a lot of ground contaminants, which could be anything that has floated through the air and has now landed on the floor, which could lead to a large case of exposure for, again, different pathogens and other types of harmful material for them. And so what we've had to do over the process of this project is actually get a lot of feedback from firefighters, and we're very fortunate enough to get a lot. We've had multiple Zoom calls with firefighters and actually sent them surveys giving us insight on how their family feels about their job, what exactly the job pertains to them doing, both on and off the shifts. And we've had a lot of great mentors come to talk to us about each of our respective fields of working. We've had talks with biology and explanations on how coding works, a lot of electrical and manufacturing help as well. And we've been given a lot of different ranges of boots to work with from the firefighters that we've been talking to, as well as a training group that is also part of the GRCTC. Because of this, we've had a lot of different prototypes with the actual FRBC itself. And it's allowed us to get a more efficient way to actually see improvement in cleaning rather than just estimating if it's cleaning or not.
Now, to give explanation on what our device is and what kind of design criteria we have, we ended up taking up the task of cleaning their boots, which is why we designed a large box with reflective insides that uses UVC. The reason why we used UVC is because of various factors. First, we had to have something that was extraordinarily rugged, which let us use metals as our primary construction material, as firefighters tend to be rough with a lot of their equipment, they wanted this thing to be a workhorse for them. Because of this, we were allowed to use, or we had readily left access to reflective materials like this sheet metal that was internally polished, which let us use things like UVC, which is what we ended up deciding on for various modicum of reasons. Primarily being, it has no equipment downtime after they've been sanitized. With other forms of sanitization, the firefighters have to wait for their boots to dry or other types of cleaning leaves their boots rendered useless for a couple of hours maybe at a time, in which case they don't know if they'll get another call. Buying more pairs of boots is also a fairly expensive answer to the issue, as they'll also have to keep maintenance of which shoes have been cleaned and rotate them efficiently, not to mention the boots themselves are very expensive. We also had to have short cleaning times so that the firefighters wouldn't be discouraged to actually clean their boots after each call if they have enough time. Have it be something that they find as mandatory, like brushing their teeth every morning, so that they maintain a hygienic routine with one of their most important pieces of equipment. Here we have a demonstration of the ease of use. Firefighters wanted very simple mechanisms so that they don't have to think about how to operate the machine. It is simply put your boots in, close it, and press a button on the top left corner, and your boots will cycle for 5 minutes until they are done. They can also be taken out of their enclosure if a call comes in while the boots are being sanitized and the UVC lights will turn on. There we have a demonstration of how the boots rotate on the turntable to ensure that every side is properly dosed with UVC.
Thank you. So overall, we just had, like Vanessa said, the UVC light, turntable to make sure that there's no blind spots while turning around in the FRBC. And the design is, as we said, really rugged and is actually only 3 minutes. We've actually gotten a lot of feedback on why 3 minutes, just that we'll go into later. But it's just a super simple design, and compared to different companies and competitors that have also been using UVC technology, the turntable, again, ensures no blind spots. A lot of the time, there'll be shadows overlooming in the big crates, as you can see. And the frame allows for the firefighters to kind of hit on it, and nothing will be broken or damaged for the long-term run, and it's significantly cheaper. The cost of materials alone is only $1,500, and compared to the competitors, that will cost way more. Sometimes the cleaning isn't even nearly as effective. And as for the more liquid bleach and as these citrus-free solutions, while they do sometimes make the boots smell better, that doesn't really matter. What we're trying to do is eliminate bacteria growth and any form of carcinogens on the boots that can cause potential cancers or much more harmful things to firefighters in the long-term run.
Now, actual construction of our box, it is a cube made out of square steel tubing with sheet metal walls. The insides have been polished to be perfectly mirrors, perfectly reflective. Thus, our UVC will bounce around in our chamber until it runs into the boots to help sanitize the areas. The boots are suspended on a wire turntable mesh, which allows them to have UVC bounce down and onto the soles, which we deemed as something that was very important to do, since the soles come into contact with a lot of different surfaces that could be potentially contaminated with various materials that the firefighters would not want to have long-time exposure with. We have two bulbs, one on each side, that are each 36 watts. They provide fairly adequate sanitization for our boots, and they lead into the electronics, which are behind the mirrored panel that can kind of be seen if you're able to tell which side is the mirror and which side is the actual turntable. The box has been built as a cube so that it can be easily stacked on top of each other. So firefighter stations can have multiple of these in a giant rack, so each of them can constantly be sanitizing multiple boots at a time.
In the back of our box, we have the electrical circuit. On the top left is our 12 voltage power supply, which then goes to our voltage regulators, which prevent the motor driver from overheating. Then goes to the Arduino, which is covered by the shield to make sure it's safe. And then we have wires through the top that go to the button, which also has an LED, and we have the momentary switches in the front as well. Then on the bottom right, we have the solid state relay that then powers the UV lights. On the bottom right, we have the terminal block and the inline fuses, which prevent everything from overheating and causing any unconventional fires. Next is our coating. The image isn't very, you can't really see what's going on, but a brief overview. This is our main loop. It's called the sanitization procedure. And what happens is that the box will detect that the limit switches are closed, therefore the box is closed. And then from there, I just had to pause for a minute. Okay, after the box detects that doors closed, the UV light and the turntable will start simultaneously. The turntable goes in steps to ensure that there's no overheating. And then whenever the box is open, it goes into emergency interrupt. Therefore, the light and the turntable will stop and the LED will blink. So we have run it for 3 minutes and it's been successful each time. But if they need to take the boots out, it's okay. If the door is open, the UV light does turn off, which will keep the firefighter safe from being exposed by any light. And then now back to John.
So as I said before, I was a medical lead, and the GRCTC doesn't necessarily have a lab for growing bacteria, so we kind of made one in the engineering closet, which you can see back there. It was a little cramped, but it got the job done. We just had an incubator, and we would swab the boots with, they were cotton swabs that were like, we got on Amazon practically. And it was to make sure that there was no contamination before the boot, anything on the boot was put on a petri dish. And we grew them for intervals of 48 hours. And after we would get them, we would see whether or not that the boot was cleaned. And there was multiple tests of how long do we want the boot in the box? What is an optimal time? And we discovered that 1 to 2 minutes just didn't do anything. It was practically just the same fill that was initially grown at 0 minutes. And we found that 4 to 5 minutes was barely better than 3 minutes. And 3 minutes was the sweet spot that we could tell firefighters, you know, the same thing that you would tell a kid if they're brushing their teeth for the first time, a minimum amount of time to get ensured cleaning. And so 3 minutes was what we found was gonna be the best solution compared to cleaning solutions such as Lysol, which are actual liquid cleaning agents that have chemicals in them. However, firefighters told us directly they don't want any other chemical interferences with their boots. They already come with enough contact with carcinogens that do enough harm to them that they want it to be completely chemical free. So after the UVC turns around for about 3 minutes and it gets all sides of the boot, we've had multiple tests with both really old dirty boots and boots from training firefighters to show that this is a perfect amount of time that'll actually clean the boot and that this is the best results that we've gotten. And as for the project's gonna be moving on hopefully to the next year, we've tried to come in contact with other personal equipment such as gloves and helmets. And specifically with helmets, we discovered a material called Nomex, which is a flame retardant material that helps protect the firefighters from any excess heat on their heads because you don't want a warm head while in a burning building. However, it is very difficult to clean as of now. The UVC, that intensity that would require, is well over what we're comfortable using. So we're gonna leave that to the next year's team. But as you can see, we kind of dabbled with cleaning it, and the exterior part of the helmet, which is hardened leather, wasn't really that difficult to clean off. But the Nomex itself, after 20 years of never being washed, pretty filthy, pretty gross. We're not really gonna be capable of doing anything but this year, but hopefully next year we'll be able to handle it better. And here's their essence of sustainability.
Now on sustainability, one of the things we wanted to target was to not have them use as many cleaning agents. This will reduce the impacts with actual cleaning agents that evaporate into the air, as well as the plastic waste that they produce when the bottles are empty. The box itself is designed to serve for decades on end. It's made with easily available and very cheap components. It is easy to disassemble and repair, so it can go from cradle to cradle or just simply keep trudging on throughout the decades for firefighters. Things like the bulbs are also long lasting and easy to replace. The largest impact is actually in production, but considering these boxes should last hopefully half of a century that is less of an impact than the tons of bottles of waste that firefighters produce when they continue using liquid agents for all of their cleaning. This would also make their boots hopefully last a lot longer, as they'll be damaged less by cleaning agents, for example, Lysol or citrus squeeze, which can were originally not even recommended by the manufacturers. They can cause damage to adhesives, shrink the boots, warp leathers, and in general, shortens the lifespan of the boots. But since firefighters need clean equipment, and that's all they have for now, they have to deal with boots that have shortened lifespans due to their cleaning procedures. And as for the next steps we're going to be seeing this fall, we've actually come in contact with the fire department, and they're going to be offering us their current, their on-site boots that they'll be using. We'll receive the boots from at the GRCTC, put them in the FRBC, and run them every once in a while for up to 3 months. We'll give the boots back to the firefighters. Before we give them back, every time we're going to swab them and put them on a petri dish. And over time, we're actually hoping to see a reduction in bacteria growth. If this is the case and we're actually successful in this, we'll be able to move on to the next step, which is going to be the specific cleaning of gloves and helmets and potentially hoods. With this, we'll actually be adding other apparatuses to the turntable, potentially putting like little like holders or placements that we can actually put the gloves on top of. Next, we'll be able to make a different version of the FRBC, hopefully adding different modifications to it. See if we can improve it any which way, potentially making it larger or attached to other, like stacking it. And then because the funding from Lumel Center MIT is going to be, shut off, we'll be able to go to what the firefighters is, the firefighter conference, to get other grants and ways to get funding for the FRBC. And that way we continue the project even when we're not a part of Lumel Center. But still, the opportunity in itself has been amazing. We've been able to do a lot of great work with a lot of amazing mentors, getting great insight on both engineering, marketing, and media, which is all going to be a part of the future for this project still. And just a huge thanks to everybody that's been involved with this, Lemelson included. Thank you so much for this opportunity. We really appreciate it, and we've been able to do great work. Thank you.
Great work.
And if there's any questions, our teams at home weren't able to ask any, so we'll be here to ask them, answer the questions.
Any questions yet in the chat? I'll ask you what I asked the other groups. Now, if you were to go back in time and give yourself some advice, what would you say?
Do each of you guys want to answer your version of it?
Sure. Oh, I would say in the beginning, it was COVID time, so we were all online. I would say for us to do more research about the medical part, and that's about it.
For me personally, it would be ask questions. At the very beginning, I was like, oh, I should be able to handle this. I got this. And at one point, we were interviewed, and they asked me, like, how do you feel about this? And I had, like, no idea what to say, and I wish I asked more questions and was able to, like, at one point, I realized it's okay to be wrong. It's okay to say, like, hey, I have no idea. But in the beginning, I was like, oh, I got this. You know, this, I can, I'm an engineer. No, I'm not. I was still learning a lot of the stuff. So I kind of like just allowed myself to be wrong. And that helped me, that opened a lot of doors to, you know, learning a lot of great things.
I would probably go back and mention small technical hurdles that we've had to go through, design iterations, probably just to have our second prototype have been the metal version, as it turns out that the metal version was very convenient to work with for long periods of time. We had our other class, we had the production of it outsourced to another class in the school, which let us focus on other things for a while at the time, saving us a lot of manpower and time and resources in general, at least mentally speaking. So we could focus better on the developing the concept and developing medical trials and other types of research for our functioning products to ensure that it did function as we intended it to.
I have a question here. What was your biggest obstacle that you faced through this process?
Well, again, do you each want to?
I mean, I think in general was actually finding the finalized box, because there's so much like, what if this, what if that, and all the team was all over the place. So I think each part of our team was like, there was a medical team, there was an engineering and electrical team, or a manufacturing team, but we'd all be so all over the place that when we finally got together, we were like presenting ideas, and they were different from other ideas. We weren't talking while working as a group. So when we finally came together at one point, we said we need to start discussing what we're doing while we're doing it. And that was the solution to that. It was actually saying, hey, this is what I'm thinking as manufacturing, does electrical and coding agree with me before I do it? And then y'all say, no, I don't like that. We're so separated and we're just doing the same project. That was not working at all. So when we finally got together and said, hey, is this a thumbs up or a thumbs down? And we finally started talking to each other, that helped actually move the project along rather than asking questions that we didn't answer each other.
When working remotely, something that you're not used to is, I guess, communication, active communication, so that everyone is always up to speed, as opposed to if everyone was in person, it's almost impossible to not be up to speed. When you see everyone else around you working on something, you'll find something that catches your eye, you'll probably ask about it, or you'll overhear conversations, or people will just walk over and actually talk to you about what they're doing. But online, that's not as possible, mostly because a lot of us might not be entirely used to being online even still after all this time, and so being up to speed became an important thing to keep up with, as otherwise we would break off and start working on different pieces of the puzzles that don't quite fit together as we were hoping they would, because we would have flawed visions of what everyone else was working on just because there was a lack of communication there.
So Hilary has a question for you guys. She says, great job. And what throughput would you expect from your cleaning process?
Can we translate that, please?
I don't quite comprehend throughput.
Yeah, what's funny is, since Hilary is a panelist here, she could actually ask it herself, but I think she means the rate at which the parts, the boots could go through your system. If I'm interpreting that correctly, Hilary, am I?
You've got it, exactly. Okay.
So you want to know the turnaround time between one boot pair cleans and the other boot pair?
Yep.
Oh, well, I mean, it would be the 3 minutes. Yeah, you put it in for 3 minutes. And then, the biggest concern for us is opening it whenever a call was made, because you saw like 20 seconds later, all of their old little like slipper shoes that they would wear on at the station were all over the place, and they were just driving out. So the 3 minutes, you can just put it in, and you can just be like, all right, my boots are done. Next pair, 3 minutes, and it should just keep going over and over and over. It's just a 3 minute interval, as many boots as you can fit in a day or in an hour.
So the next part of her question was, and I'm gonna kind of put my own twist on this as well. Her question is, what's the most important next step? Now, what I want you to think about in this is, how many of you are seniors and you're part about the communication piece? How does this translate into students that are now going to join into being part of this project and those of you who are leaving and abandoning it?
So all of us have actually graduated. So the next class that will come in is going to be entirely new. A very important thing will be leaving behind all of the documentation, all
how-tos, sketches, CADs,
so that they can pick it up, study what we've done, and then keep working from there. They themselves will have to catch themselves up to speed, but some of us will likely come back as mentors if they really do need extra assistance to grasp the project or just help with trying to modify something or adapt it or with just new ideas in general. We've had a lot of mentors that are able to do that, and a lot of them will likely be coming back next year as well to help the new batch of students continue working on this project, which will help bridge the gap between what we've done this year and helping the next year produce more add-ons to this thing.
But the next big step, as we put in the slideshow, was we're gonna actually have a fire department come to us, give them their boots on a 48-hour cycles, like every week for 3 months. And with that, we'll actually be able to actively test if the FRBC is cleaning these boots. And hopefully by giving the firefighter their boots back on their shift, we're giving them significantly cleaner boots. They're already going to be feeling more comfortable, and this directly proves that our invention works,
and it's not just a box with a light bulb in it.
Yeah.
Hopefully, on top of making them feel more comfortable, it'll also make them a lot more conscious of when they should be cleaning their gear after coming into contact with hazardous scenarios. Entering people's houses can be a roll of dice, for example. You don't know how cleanly they are or what might be on the floor. So then after leaving, they might not always remember to clean their boots because of they're so busy with figuring out the situation and helping out the situation.
From the question and answer, did you consider first responders equipment before you decided on firemen equipment?
We wanted to focus right now on firefighter equipment, but this will be adapted properly so that first responders in general can work with it. Every fire crew has two EMTs, so we will be getting feedback from EMTs as well on what they think of the box. The F in FRBC actually does stand for first responder. So we do intend to make this available for all kinds of first responders so that they can all maintain cleanly equipment, since a lot of them go into the same or very similar calls.
So one last question for you. And this is from the question and answer. What's the largest obstacle you overcame during this process? And what did you learn by overcoming that problem?
To each of you guys.
Yeah, for medical, it was at one point our incubator was being weird and we didn't know whether we were growing bacteria or not. And we had Mike Silvera, our biologist mentor, told us like, hey, just keep trying. And if nothing works, then do what you know you're comfortable with. And eventually we found that we just kept doing research and we kept like, if one thing wasn't working, don't give up and just be like, oh, well, we can't do anything anymore. We continue researching, we continue working with other groups, and we continue asking questions to the firefighters that we still had. And eventually when the incubator, you know, got back to normal, we got our proper bacteria growth back together again. We had noticed that we had already done so much work already that we were able to just focus on bacteria testing. And it was a huge weight off of our shoulders. And we were really glad that we didn't just waste time doing nothing and like moping that it wasn't working. And it just showed, you know, if one thing doesn't work, don't focus on that one thing not working. Go figure out everything else. And then hopefully when that starts working back up again, you'll notice you already got all the other work out the way, so you can now focus on what isn't working for so long. And it just makes the process easier.
Awesome.
On the mechanical aspects, one of the biggest hurdles was, generally speaking, production. Despite simpler systems, because of this thing's large volume and rugged design, production turnover times can be very lengthy, and you need to have a lot of communication between your team, the manufacturing team that will produce something that your team can't, for example, the actual metal construction, and then consider all the different input that we have, as in our requirements for what this needs to fulfill, what teams can produce in the reasonable amount of time that we're asking of them, and make something that fits all of those requirements with a reasonable turnaround time for production to come to testing. Another big thing when it comes to designing prototypes, you have to be able to work forward from it. So you want to design this thing not only so that it can be disassembled, for example, at the end of its life, but so that you can disassemble and replace and change out layouts and components while you're producing it, so that you're sure if you have this thing now, you can keep working with this prototype in the future to design a better everything else around the prototype that you've designed in the past. So there's a lot of future-proofing that you have to consider. And to consider the future-proofing, you have to make sure your team and the manufacturing team can produce something that will be reasonably future-proof. For example, an unfeasible thing would be making the whole thing bolt assembled.
That's great. Awesome. Well, very thoughtful answers. Fantastic invention. I think the whole group is inspired. The goal of Lemelson was to inspire young inventors of all ages, those who are considering going into the field to pursue it. the things that you do when you invent. You make the world a better place, you solve problems. And we witnessed that today. We witnessed that from our high school students, our undergrad and our graduate award winner. And I think the world will be a better place if you guys continue to do that work. Oh, Charlotte, we had an ending slide here. So thank you very much to all the high school students, the teachers and mentors who worked with them, as well as our undergraduate graduate award winner. Again, I'm certainly inspired, and I hope the rest of you are. It was a fantastic afternoon. You all did great work. You should be proud of yourself.